and welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home. I'm Marlo Artis, and I'm the moderator of the program. Tar Heel Teachers at Home is a video cast focused on engaging North Carolinians in conversations around education. Each week, I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. We'll start our introductions with our elementary school panelists.
Hi, my name is Amy Tarr. I teach fifth grade math and science for Clay County Schools, and you can find me on Twitter at Cards for Scholars.
Good evening. My name is Cassandra Parsons. I'm an EC middle school teacher in Cumberland County Schools at Spring Lake Middle. You can follow me on Twitter at CParsonEC.
Good evening. My name is Micah Tweetmeyer. I teach biology at Riverside High School in Durham. And you can follow me on Twitter at Micah J. Hunter.
Hi, I'm Marquita Mitchell. I am a magnet program specialist for the Charlotte-Mecklenburg School System. And you can follow me on Twitter at Mark Mitch, MarkMitch.
Thank you so much for being with us, Marquita. We appreciate it. For this episode of Tar Heel Teachers at Home, we have the great pleasure of speaking with Dr. Anona Smith Williams. She is the Associate Dean of Student Success and Strategic Community Engagement at NC State University. She works in the School of Education, and she's here to talk about the LIFT program as well as some other ways that NC State is working to diversify the teaching force here in North Carolina. So please welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home, Dr. Anona Smith Williams.
Good evening. Thank you for having me this evening and allowing me the opportunity to talk about how we are addressing the challenge that the state is currently having in diversifying its educator teacher force. So thank you.
Well, we're so glad to chat with you about this, Dr. Smith Williams. So before we talk about LIFT, tell us how you made the decision to get an education and tell us about some of your experiences that you've had in your career around education.
So I started when I was an undergrad. I went to a school in Virginia. And so when I was an undergrad, I really kept thinking about the challenges that I had in being successful as far as just attending a university and thinking about the different career options. And so I knew that I wanted to kind of work in a field where I could help other students to kind of navigate that a little easier, because I went to a very large predominantly white institution and just felt very overwhelmed. And so I knew I wanted to work with particular populations of students. And so I kept thinking and looking around at, well, what can I do without a master's? And so I got into admissions. And so I started back in, at that time, they were called minority recruitment admissions counselors, where schools were hiring people to try to improve their enrollment of students of color. And so I did that for several years and realized that I really wanted to then work with them once they get to a university and how to help them matriculate through a university. And that's when I kind of switched gears from admissions and went more into student support and student success, and decided to then continue my education in that sphere. And so I've worked at Women's College, a co-ed, kind of a Quaker school, co-ed, and then a large research. So I think all of those things, the common thread has been, how can we better support students? How can we help students be successful and graduate? So that's kind of been my journey.
That's wonderful. And how did you end up at NC State?
Because I realized that I really needed a doctorate to really, people kept telling me, you know, you really need a master's. When I got my master's, they were saying, oh, you really need a doctorate. So it's just that kind of cycle, and realized that if I was going to be at NC State, why not take advantage of that? And so decided to work on my doctorate. And so that's kind of how I did it. And I knew that to really, really do the types of things I wanted to do, I really need to understand the research and understand and work with faculty and really try to make change. And so I thought that the education was just a good way to help bring those two worlds together.
That's wonderful. And at NC State, one way that you all are working to diversify the teaching force in our state is through the LIFT program, which is the Leadership Institute for Future Teachers. Mm-hmm. So tell us about that, Dr. Smith Williams.
So back in 85 or 86, a faculty member and I were thinking about, we had just got the Teaching Fellows program at NC State, and we were probably the only one or maybe two that had the program, and started thinking about how can we get more students of color thinking about teaching, because a lot of, you know, it's not a popular thing. So you don't really have parents and guidance counselors and teachers saying, you know, this is the ultimate thing, please do it. So we're trying to think, how can we help students connect with other students who are interested? How can we? And so we came up with the Leadership Institute for Future Teachers. Many of our teaching fellows of color came through that program. They are graduates who are APs and still teaching and doing things in education. And then it stopped for several years because of funding and cuts. And then, as you know, with all the media, we all know the data about the percentage of teachers of color in the field. And so we felt like we were just going backwards in time when we looked at our student enrollment. And when you look at college events across the state and country, the number of students of color that are coming in really mirrors the number of teachers that are in the classroom, and thought, you know, it's really time to do things. So we have been doing little things and thought we need to get more aggressive. And so we wrote a grant to the University Foundation so we could get this going again, because just felt we had to really get out there and work with high school students and get them to really understand just the field of education and develop the leadership skills to be competitive for certain scholarships too.
What questions do we have for Dr. Smith Williams?
I can tell you a little bit more about the leadership to help them. So it's a 5-day residential program, and it's free of cost except for travel to and from Raleigh. And so they will be involved in leadership development. They'll be involved with meeting different education leaders from across the state, do a lot of intensive kind of innovative thinking and projects around education and leadership. And one of the nice things about this institute is that we know from the research that many of these students, about 50% so far, are first generation. And we know that the importance of support and supporting parents, parents who've had students who've gone off to college, is overwhelming that senior year. So you know, if it's your first or your fourth, it's an overwhelming experience. So we plan on continuing our support. And so these students will have e-mentors. So when they leave, they'll be working with e-mentors. We have faculty who've developed a mentoring app. And so these students will be assigned a mentor while they're there, and they'll continue to work with that mentor during their senior year. And then we'll also have the parents assigned a parent coach, so we can work with the parents to help them during that senior year also. And bringing them back to campus in the fall and the spring for Lift Academies to make sure we're supporting the students and the parents and the families.
That's great. Mm-hmm. How many will you accept?
So we're accepting 30 students right now. We have about 161 nominations. So we sent out information, and so we have a nomination form for school officials. And then we also have a self-nomination form, because we really, you know, oftentimes I think back to the other Teaching Fellows program when you had to go through the guidance counselor. And sometimes guidance counselors weren't aware of some of the students who were interested in teaching. And so this way we also talk to nonprofits. And so that way, if a parent or the director at a Y or a counselor, someone today said their girlfriend is interested, and so someone nominated her. So we wanted to make sure we weren't missing anyone. So of the 161, about 130 are through the school system, and we have about 28 students who self-nominated themselves.
I think that's great.
Mm-hmm. And we'll select 30.
Mm-hmm. And so I have a question.
Yes.
So in middle school, they are allowed to apply for the early colleges and start that through high school. So my question is, what are some of the initiative or things we can do to help our students be college ready, even in middle school? you know, you're starting with high school. We know it begins with middle school. Middle school says it begins at elementary school.
Right.
So what are some of the things as middle school teachers that we can do or put in place besides, you know, in the early colleges to help our students be better prepared for these types of programs?
Agreed. So one of the, we have another initiative that I'll talk about later because it's a land grant. At the core of our mission, there are only two college events in the state that are land grant, and that's us and the Great A&T. And so at the core of our mission is how can we really address the disparities and opportunity gaps that exist in the state that disproportionately impact rural communities, communities of color, and economically distressed communities. And so part of that is how do we start early? And so with regard to access, and well, it's a little different. We're also working sometimes with middle school students, just getting them college ready. And then there's that piece about how to still diversify the educator workforce, which is a whole nother topic. But just getting them college ready, part of a program that we have called Ed Scholars, part of that was what we're trying to develop is more targeted after school programs. So we have the teacher cadet programs at the high school level, but how can we work with after school programs so we can come in and really work with students to help get them thinking about college, understanding, demystifying it. We're the only college that I know of on NC State's campus that we invite middle school students to campus. So NC State is so large, we have so many visitors coming, it's hard to accommodate middle school students and elementary school students that we feel is kind of our mission to still work with middle school students. So already we've had over 100 students, middle school students on campus, because we feel that's the first step, is just letting them just really get a feel for college life, talking to them about what high school is like. We also have a program in our Say Village, the College of Ed, where our students go into middle schools and work with them after school. So we start with elementary. So we have about 50 to 60 students in our Living and Learning Village. And we have our incoming students work with first year students at the elementary school level. So they already get to interact with college students. And it's not tutoring, it's more about self-advocacy. How can we help these students start learning how to kind of find their own voice? And then we have the students work with middle school students called DAY, Determined Area Youth, where we go in and work with middle school students to get them ready for high school, because we know that's where students kind of, if they're not happy at the middle school level, they're gonna dread going on to high school. So we try to work with those middle school students to get them start thinking about being ready for high school. The principals will, usually the guidance counselors will identify the students that they feel should be a part of that group. And then we added on LEAD, where we're working with high school students and getting them just ready for life, getting them ready for their next step. Because we know everyone's not going to college, but we want everyone to kind of have a goal in mind so they can kind of start that journey and thinking about it. So that's how we're just kind of starting with the elementary, middle, and high school with these programs.
So do you all have a percentage of a success rate, like a couple of numbers you can throw around for a success rate of the students that actually go through the program?
So the program has gone, I'll definitely have to get back with you on that one, because the program has been going on for over 10 years. And we are in the process, we just had our evaluation, and so we're in the process of collecting. We have found it's very difficult because once the students leave elementary school, they go to different feeder schools, and so sometimes we have a hard time in tracking the students, and so we actually have a plan in place to, which I can send you the report, so we're working on that now, looking at, we know how many students we're able to track the students year by year. And so principals and the guidance counselors will send us information on how those students are doing. Because these programs are not about, our metrics is not about their academic record. It's more about their persistence. And some of these students have just already in third grade tuned out. And so it's really about how do we keep them engaged. A little harder to assess that personal transformation than the academic, so it's more behavior. So they'll send us data on if that student was not called to the office, if that student seems to be, you know, just healthier and kind of more emotionally stable. Mm-hmm. So I can send you where, because it's a lot of data, but I can send you some information on how well those students are doing. We have students who were participants in SAE as children who are old enough now to be at NC State and other colleges.
I had a question about the cohorts you bring in into the School of Education. Okay. And as you're working to diversify the incoming groups of future educators, is there anything being done to encourage them to go back to the communities where they've come from to then help recruit others? And then they people in their community can see people that look like them?
Yes. So when I went back to our land grant mission, so there are several things that we're doing because we know that we're not going to be able to graduate enough teachers. What's happening in a lot of our rural communities and distressed communities is that 21 and 22 years are not going back to those areas. And so what we've developed is a program called our Education Scholars. So we're helping communities. And so we're encouraging our students, instead of just staying in Wake County or going to Mecklenburg County, you know, our students outperform our graduates in the field are ranked number one as far as outperforming their counterparts. So we know we're producing strong teachers, especially in STEM. And so we want all counties to benefit from that. And so we have something called Ed Scholars that we started, but we're working with certain communities and we're having those student teach in those communities so they can start living and working and becoming leaders in those communities and seeing what it's like. Because once they student teach in Wake County or Mecklenburg County, they hand them a contract and they're good to go. So the idea was pulling them out of student teaching in these counties and having them student teach and live for a semester in these counties and in those counties, and then they work there hopefully for 2 years. And so they're called Ed Scholars. We currently have 5 teachers who are in the field, and then we have 5 students right now who are student teaching. We opened up our applications and we have 30 students right now who want to be a part of this, who want to go out and work in rural communities or urban areas that many people may not want to go to. During spring break, we also have a trip called We Teach for NC, where we put our students on a Greyhound-sized bus and we take them to these counties over their spring break, and they're treated like rock stars because we told the superintendents, you had a football team coming to your town, you would roll out the red carpet and you do everything you can. So we told them, we're going to bring them, but you have to treat them like rock stars. This has to be a joint effort between us. And they rolled out the red carpet. These students met the superintendents. They went into schools. The schools had little programs for them. The community leaders came out. We took them to Kinston, Craven, Onslow, and then we took them to Wayne because we wanted them to see an inner city school. Wayne High School, and they were, I think that was probably the highlight of their trip because they had not been in a school where the bathroom, you couldn't go into the bathroom at a certain time because it was locked, or a security guard was in the school, or that the walls were peeling. And so they got to see the disparities that exist, which I think is important, between certain communities based on tax and income. And so those are some of the things that we are really aggressively doing to put our students out there. We also just started last year a Grow Your Own program with Johnston County, because even the counties around us suffer because, you know, if you're in Johnston County, you just cross the line and Wake County can pull you in. And so, but if you look at Selma and Smithfield, Johnston County is still very rural and still economically distressed communities. Mm-hmm. And so we help them with their Grow Your Own program, where we start an associate in science with a teaching option. And so those students go through their high school, Smithfield Selma, and go through their teach a cadet program, and then we work with them at the high school level to build to Johnson Community College. Then they come to NC State, they do all their field work in Johnson County, and then go back to Johnson County to teach. So those are some of the things we're doing to kind of help across the state.
That's great. Thank you so much for sharing that.
Yeah.
So I am a North Carolina State alum, and I wish I had this opportunity when I came through, just because I initially wanted to be to accept my teaching fellow scholarship, but I accepted another scholarship because I didn't want to get boxed in. I did the lateral entry route, and I ended up in education anyway. I just wish this opportunity had been there for me and I had known about it during that time. But I just wonder, with all of the work that you've done, which is amazing, what have you learned? What has come out of this work that you would say would be the biggest takeaway for you when it comes to the field of education?
I think the biggest takeaway is that as people talk, when you think about collective impact, that I think we need to think about that business model and how we need to really talk more to different partners, learn more from different people out there that are doing innovative things. And it's not competition. That again, I just feel very blessed to work at a land grant where I know we're not regionally focused, that it's okay to work and to help others. And I think that if more and more people, I know we were at the table for the Drive Conference because I thought it was so important to share what we have and the knowledge we have with other people. And so I think the takeaway is that as communities and community leaders and the business community really understand that what educators are doing is driving their workforce development. When people think about workforce development, they don't think about teachers, where in most of these counties, the school system is the biggest driver, the biggest payroll. And so how can we really develop them? I heard a superintendent at Cabarrus say, and it stuck with me, that strong school districts create strong communities. And that's so important. And so when we think about communities that are dying, why would someone want to send that, why would a young couple want to move somewhere where there's a school system that they feel isn't a great school system? And so I think as we take ownership of all of these school systems and all of these communities and start talking more together, I think that's my biggest takeaway. And I think that that's definitely evolving as more nonprofits are getting involved, as more people are trying to do things to address this. What y'all are doing is great. It's just people bringing attention to it. I think that has been the greatest high for me, is just seeing how it's baby steps, but I think more people are engaged and fighting this huge war.
Thank you.
What is your hope for other university and colleges in the state? It sounds like you guys are really leading this initiative and doing so much. What do you think some other universities and colleges in the area across the state could be doing to help your mission as well?
Yeah, you know, and I don't want to make it seem like we are the only ones, because I think every college of education in the state is trying to do what they can with the limited resources that we have. And so, I think as long as we continue to come together and talk about best practices, and because every student that comes to me, I know there's not going to, NC State's not the right fit, but if they are passionate about teaching, then I have no problem picking up the phone. No one has a problem picking up the phone and saying, I think this is a good fit for you, or why don't you look at this website? So I think as we, because I wouldn't consider any of us competitive. So I think as we all just try to keep having open conversations, I think that we'll all continue to kind of be in this together.
Where do you see the teaching profession going in the next 5 years if these initiatives keep going? Do you have a positive outlook for it?
I do, but I also know realistically that all the things that we're doing, in particular when we're talking about diversifying the educator workforce, is going to take a long time to change these percentages, 80%. And so I think what we're trying to do is make sure that every student that is wants to be a classroom teacher graduates culturally responsive, culturally competent, because we want to put all students out there, regardless of the ethnicity, because we're not going to be able to put a teacher of color in every school, and so, or, you know, make that balance. And so what we're trying to do is just really work hard in trying to make sure that we graduate teachers. So in 5-10 years, that some of the challenges that we are seeing in classrooms from maybe teachers who may not be as culturally responsive, that we will at least make an impact that way.
Mm-hmm. So Dr. Smith Williams, what are some of the incentives for the Ed Scholars? I know the intrinsic, if they have a chance to work in these communities, but what are some of the incentives that really, that they could, those tangible incentives that they could really mm-hmm. hold on to participate in the Ed Scholarship, yeah. a scholars mm-hmm. program?
Yes. So we started this program with TIP, which is the Innovation Project. And so they already had different districts a part of their nonprofit. And so we talked with superintendents to say, you know, there needs to be some type of incentive to get a 21-year-old to think about this. So part of it is that they have to, while they're doing their student teaching, the county is responsible for finding some type of housing for them. We're treating it like a host family. So when you go overseas, you stay with a host family to cut down on costs. So the county has to find a host family or some type of living arrangement for the students. At the end of the student's first year, they receive $5,000 from the county, which is $2,500 at the end of, like at Christmas time, and then $2,500 at the end of their first year. $5,000 is less than what they typically would pay a Teach for America recruit. So they're actually getting a licensed teacher with typically a strong content to come into their system. So that's kind of the incentive. Mm-hmm.
That's good. Are you hearing any districts really talking about partnering more about getting these special housing for teachers only? I know they have it in Asheville and Buncombe, and they have it in Hoke. I mean, some of that could help too if they actually have some teaching housing yes. available in these communities.
Yes. I know Craven County is thinking about how they can create that type of situation, because that's why Kinston, when I say Lenoir County, these students are going to Kinston and they are really loving it. And there was a time when people go, where's Kinston? Oh, I drive through it and I keep going, I don't stop. but Kinston has this little art district or music district with these little cottages. And so they put the students up there. Cabarrus has a house where they house all of their student teachers. So they go right into this nice, and so I think that really helps, especially if you're talking about a 20-year-old going to a town, like a college advising corps. Mm-hmm. A lot of them have challenges finding housing because there are no apartments in some of these
right.
communities. So I agree. I think that's when I was talking to her about what can those, of having more businesses join in, people who have land, developers, how can they come to the table and help with this issue when you just have, you can't find an apartment complex? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What other questions do we have?
One other thing I'll share also is build. So when talk again, our land grant, this isn't about recruitment necessarily, but our land grant mission, we have a build is called Brothers United in Leadership Development. And we invite over 100 males of color high school students to come to campus on a Saturday. The metric again isn't can they get into college. These students, unlike Lyft, those students, about 75% have GPAs between a 3.5 and a 4.0 or higher. These students could have a 2.0, anywhere from a 4.0. We don't know. That's not what it's about. It's about bringing young men to campus and helping them to find their strengths, to think about how to articulate their gifts, and how to, in a positive way, voice that. And they come together and they have this brotherhood, and we have males come in and talk to them and run them through workshops. And it's just a great experience. Sometimes we're able to have the fraternities at the end, because some of them, other than TV, has never seen that. And they talk about brotherhood versus brotherhood. And so it's just a good day. It's a feel-good day, and that's March 28th. And that's when, you know, so it's just really good experience. That's just another thing we do to try to demystify the college experience, because some of these young men, no one has told them that. Have you thought about college, or what are you going to do after high school?
Well, Dr. Smith Williams, we commend you on this rich work that you all are doing at NC State. Mm-hmm. We know it has to be very rewarding. It's difficult work, because there's some difficult conversations, and the data can be a little bit demoralizing. But when you really are talking with individual students and families, you really feel like you're making an impact and you're moving in the right direction.
You're right. And I feel blessed to have a leadership. The leadership in the College of Education really supports all of this and is really a driver. And you can't do this work without that. So I feel really blessed to work in a college where we have that type of leadership.
Well, that's wonderful. Well, we appreciate you coming on and talking about what you all are doing at the NC State School of Education. And anything that we can do to support, please let us know. We're glad to provide our support.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. We would like to thank our wonderful audience so very much for watching this program. We hope that you will engage us on our social media platforms. Please follow us on Twitter. Our handle is at Tar Heel Teachers. We would like for you to like our Facebook page as Tar Heel Teachers, subscribe to our YouTube channel, visit our website, tarheelteachers.com, and on all of our social media platforms, use our hashtag Tar Heel Teachers. We'd like to thank our wonderful panel for being with us for this episode, Amy Tart, Cassandra Parsons, Micah Tweetmeyer, and Marquita Mitchell. And once again, we would like to thank Dr. Anona Smith Williams for being with us. She is the Associate Dean for Student Success and Strategic Community Engagement at NC State's College of Education. We look forward to seeing you all next week on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.